Good morning and welcome to the fourth meeting of the Citizen Participation and Public Petitions Committee of 2021. And our principal agenda this morning is to discuss new petitions. Can I say to those petitioners who may be tuning in or others who are watching that we do, in advance of considering the petitions, receive submissions, including those from the Scottish Government, which help inform the discussion we're about to have. Our first petition this morning is petition number 1869 to make it law for railway stations to have free step access. And this has been lodged by Dylan Crawford. The petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce legislation that requires all railway stations in Scotland to have free step access. The Scottish Government's submission highlights work that has been undertaken, both the UK and Scottish governments, to fund accessibility improvements and create step-free access at more than 30 rail stations across Scotland's rail network. However, the submission stresses that in relation to the petition, that rail accessibility is a reserved matter and it's therefore not possible for the Scottish Parliament to actually legislate in this area as requested by the petition. So very interesting to receive the notes in relation to the work that is taking place to establish step-free access in various stations. Also, actually, other work that's undergoing to improve access in stations generally. But it does seem that there's an obstacle in terms of us considering a petition looking for a legislative solution. Colleagues, anybody wish to offer something? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Sympathy for a petition, and everybody would like to see access for all at stations, but because this is a reserved matter and the Parliament can't legislate in it, I think we should close a petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Are we agreed? Agreed. And so we'll obviously, has the petitioner been made aware of the submissions in relation to the access improvements that have been undertaken? Well, then on that basis, fine. Petition number 1870. To ensure teachers of autistic pupils are appropriately qualified. This second petition today has been lodged by Edward Fowler, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce legislation requiring teachers of autistic pupils to be appropriately qualified to improve educational outcomes. The Scottish Government submission that we've received states that the Additional Support for Learning Act 2004 as amended, provides a comprehensive legislative framework for supporting children and young people to overcome barriers to their learning and achieve their full learning potential. The submission details a variety of work with the aim of enabling teachers to support autistic children and highlights the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan, which was published in October last year. Progress made against the Action Plan is expected to be monitored and reported on next month, obviously October 21. The submission also points to qualifications that teachers can obtain to demonstrate support for children with additional support needs, such as a postgraduate certificate or diploma of inclusive practice. In their submission, the petitioner emphasises the impact of education on their experiences later in life and states that many people are now seeking answers, and I quote, as to why they were failed by the education system of Scotland. They want to know what can be done to change this and want their voices to be heard. An issue that's come before Parliament in different guises over time. Again, colleagues, would anybody like to comment on this petition? Tess White.
So I'd like to say that the petitioner does raise some very important points, which the committee should explore further. That I do understand that in 2020, around 22,000 pupils were identified as having ASD. So what I'd propose is that if we do write to the Scottish Government, if that's something that we do propose, could we think about considering adding children in Scotland to the list of stakeholders who were involved, so those children who were involved in the report, and I've got a note, publication, not included, not engaged, not involved, a report in the experiences of autistic children missing school.
Thank you. Any other contributions? So we're content then to write to the Scottish Government seeking a summary of the report on progress made against the Additional Support for Learning Action Plan, when it is published, which we expect to be in the next few weeks, so probably a nice time for us to consider the petition again. And we're going to write to key stakeholders, and in addition to Tessie's suggestion, the General Teaching Council, Scottish Council for Deans of Education, Scottish Autism and the National Autistic Society, all of whom we will ask and seek views from them on the petition and the Scottish Government submission in respect of it. So we'll hold the petition open in anticipation of that advice. Everybody content? Thank you. The next petition is petition 1871, a full review of mental health services. And we are joined for this petition this morning by our parliamentary colleague, Monica Lennon, MSP. Good morning and welcome to you, Monica. This is a new petition, a full review of mental health services, lodged by Karen McKean on behalf of Shining Lights for Change. The petition is calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to carry out a full review of mental health services in Scotland to include the referral process, crisis support, risk assessments, safe plans, integrated services working together, first response support, and the support available to families affected by suicide. The Scottish Government's submission details work underway to improve the quality, access, and variety of support provided for mental health. This includes tailored programmes to support NHS boards with long waiting lists, 24/7 mental health assessment units, and a distress brief intervention programme. In response, the petitioner has shared the story of her partner, and it was a very powerful submission. This is our partner, Luke Henderson, who died in 2017. I think anybody reading the submissions would have been naturally affected by that. Their experience in seeking support from mental health services prior to his loss. In response to deliverables against the Suicide Prevention Action Plan, the petitioner notes that the target to reduce suicide death by 20% by 2022 does not appear to currently be on track. As I say, it was a powerful submission. I understand from advice that the committee has looked at a petition along these lines from the petitioner previously. And Monica Lennon, would you care to speak in support of the petition and assist us in our consideration?
Yes, good morning, convener. Thank you, committee, for the opportunity to come today and speak in support of petition 1871. Karen McKeown is a constituent of mine in Central Scotland, and like I explained to your predecessor committee, she's become a friend through the most tragic of circumstances. Karen emailed me on the 30th of December 2017, just hours after Luke took his own life in the family home with the children in bed. And you'll have read from Karen's submission that it wasn't through a lack of speaking out, because we're all encouraged to speak out and be open about our mental health. We hear it's okay not to be okay, but Karen and Luke tried to get help multiple times. I think it was around 8 times. Sadly, Luke isn't here, but Karen is still fighting, not just for herself and her family. Their outcome will never change. But when I spoke to Karen just 2 minutes ago from outside the committee room, she impressed upon me that, you know, what happened to her family is not unique. I don't need to tell you that. We're all MSPs. We all represent communities. We all have our own mental health. So Karen is not looking for sympathy. Karen is looking for system change. She's looking for action. And Karen has now become the go-to person for many other people who sadly have gone through the same tragic loss that she has. And I won't give the person's name, but another constituent of mine that Karen is supporting, their son was suicidal and was being very vocal about how he felt. And when he went to the crisis team, he was given a leaflet. That boy is not here today. So that's why Karen's petition is so important. I acknowledge that the Scottish Government understands how serious this is, and it is a priority, but we're not getting things right. And it's not just about putting more money into the system. There are parts of the system that do need more resource. There's a workforce crisis, but there are areas where crisis support doesn't exist, risk assessments are not being carried out, people don't have safe plans, pathways are not fully in place. And we know from speaking to colleagues in Police Scotland that they're under increasing pressure. And if you are someone who is in crisis, experiencing psychosis, you know, the police coming to your door isn't really the most helpful thing, and it's a tough job for the police to do as well. So I'm grateful to have the opportunity to speak to the petition today to echo some of Karen's sentiments. This is an issue that is a national crisis that is really important, and I think it was clearly an issue before the pandemic. You know, Karen's petition predates COVID-19, but we all know that the harms around isolation, mental health, issues around alcohol and substance use as well also have to be considered. So I think we need to give a space in this parliament for people to not just share their experience, but also to share what they believe to be the solutions, because I think in Scotland we are fortunate there are people who care deeply, who are supporting each other in their communities, and to hear from the people on the front line as well. I'm very concerned about the mental health and wellbeing of people who work in our NHS, who work in community services, who work in the police, because they're having to turn people away with those leaflets, and then that gives them their own stress and anxiety. Sadly, a young doctor in Lanarkshire completed suicide recently, and I've had a lot of emails following that from doctors and people in the health service. And just the last point I would make, because our GPs have been doing a wonderful job during the pandemic and continue to do so, but for people with complex mental health needs, the video consultation, the telephone consultation doesn't work for everyone. So I think we also need to consider that in any review of mental health services. So hopefully colleagues today will take this as an opportunity. It's not to sit here and to criticise ministers or criticise the NHS, because I think everyone is trying really hard, but we're not getting it right, and people are losing their lives. So I would again just reiterate my support for the petition, and hope that the petition is an opportunity for people to contribute their thoughts, their solutions, so we can get this right and to save lives in Scotland. Thank you.
Thank you for that. I actually was quite struck, and I'm grateful to the petitioner for bringing the petition back. Obviously, I understand there was evidence taken on this in the last session. I didn't hear that, but I was quite affected by the petitioner's submission. And I also noted the ongoing difficulties that the petitioner continues to experience in relation to other individuals, family individuals and others she's seeking to support. And I take very much the point that we don't think we properly understand what additional impact the pandemic may have had, both on the Scottish Government's own programme in terms of what it's trying to achieve, and on the way in which the pandemic itself has compounded the difficulties that people are experiencing and our ability to deal with them. So I certainly start from that position. Would anybody in the committee care to comment? Tess White?
Thank you. So reading this petition was deeply moving, and the petitioner, Karen, has been through a deeply, deeply distressing experience. And I'm concerned that to hear that her partner repeatedly tried to seek mental health support in the days before his death. I know that in the previous committee, we closed a similar petition from the petitioner, and I think it was in November 2019, on the basis that the Scottish Government was undertaking significant work to address mental health services. However, given that almost 2 years have now passed, and as Monica Lennon says, you know, this predates COVID-19, I think it's important to assess what, if any, progress has actually been made. The petitioner not only raises the issue of, well, this, but suicide prevention. And in her submission, she also addresses problems accessing appropriate child and adolescent mental health services for a family following a partner's death. And I think that's really important to note. And the committee, I believe, should consider pursuing this further in any correspondence with the Scottish Government. So I do have a proposal. I do think we should write to the Cabinet Secretary seeking an update on progress on the Suicide Prevention Action Plan. I do think we should get an update on the distress brief intervention programme expansion and whether the Scottish Government is on track to achieve its 20% reduction by 2022 target. I think that's really important. And if I can just add finally, it may also be worth contacting stakeholders such as SAMH, the Royal College of Psychiatrists in Scotland, and also Samaritans Scotland, and others to get their views. I would actually like to take this wider because, as Monica Lennon says, this is a crisis and it's not going to go away. It predates COVID-19, so we do need to take action. The petitioner's submission also refers to delays in child and adolescent mental health services for self-harming behaviour. So I did note that. As well as minimal support for her autistic child. So finally, I believe it would also be appropriate to follow up on those issues. So that's my recommendation, convener.
Other colleagues wish to speak? Paul Sweeney.
Yeah, I'd just like to echo the moving testimony from Monica and representing her constituent on this issue, because I think it was an incredibly touching issue, and I think we've all had interactions with constituents and others in the past where the same themes are repeated, that when people feel they're in a crisis situation, the help isn't there. And that's a fairly devastating realisation for a lot of people who just kind of perhaps assume that when, if the worst came to the worst, someone would be there to help. And I echo the points that Tess has made about the need to widen this investigation, this inquiry, which I think is useful and we should pursue that. I would also suggest that we include prisons in the scope of this, because one of the experiences I've had relatively recently in visiting Barlinnie was the mental health crisis in the midst of our prison system, where effectively people who are suffering severe mental disability, mental health problems, are incarcerated in conditions which just are not appropriate for their condition. So effectively people who are suffering acute mental illness are being warehoused in prisons. I think that's an element of this that needs to be discussed as well. So I would suggest including the Scottish Prison Service and the organisations we're seeking to invite to discuss this with.
David Torrance, do you want to?
Thank you, convener. I agree with my colleagues, but I wonder if we could ask the Health, Social and Sport Committee if this is going to be in their work programme, because it might be best suited for them to take the petition on and take it forward that way. Still agreement, we could write and get the information back from all the different... But if they're going to dedicate the time to it, there's no point two committees doing it. So if they're going to do it, I'd like to see it passed on to Health, Social and Care and Sport Committee.
Tess Wide?
In relation to that, my concern about this, and going back to Monica Lennon's point, is that if we do pass it across to another committee, it's important that we receive their review and it doesn't get lost. You know, this is a crisis. We can't just kick it into the long grass. So I think it's really important that this committee does actually set a date when it reviews, if that's the joint view of this committee. It should not and must not be lost.
If I can sum up, I think David Torrance's suggestion is one that we should very much keep in mind. But in the first instance, and I think David Torrance is agreeing with colleagues, we will write and seek the information that you have suggested and other colleagues have suggested as well, to see what the status of all that is. I'd quite like to have those questions framed, asking for a candid assessment of what the COVID pandemic has actually done to where things were before it happened, what impact that's had on the delivery of anything, and what steps are being taken, if that has been prejudicial, to get things back on track. So I don't particularly want just to be told in response to our inquiry, of course, we've had a pandemic. We all know we've had a pandemic. I don't need to be told that. What I'd like to know is a candid understanding of what impact the pandemic has actually had and what plans are now in place to resolve that in relation to all the questions that we're putting. Otherwise, I think we'll just get, there's a potential for us to get something back telling us what we already know, when I'd rather try and find out what we're going to do about that too. So we'll keep the petition open. Thank you very much, Monica Lennon, for joining us. Are you quite happy with the course of action as we've suggested?
Yes, Convener. I'm very grateful to colleagues for their considered thoughts today. I think Tess White helpfully mentioned some of the work that's already, you know, being done around suicide prevention, distress brief interventions. I am very troubled that when we look at young people in particular, that the CAMHS waiting lists are at their highest ever, and just saying, well, it's a pandemic isn't a good enough answer. We need to know what plans are in place. But I think it's been important to have this discussion today because people are contacting us, this Parliament, looking for action, looking for support. And as I said, it's not about sympathy in warm words, it is about how we deliver system change. If the Health and Sport Committee has an interest too, then that would be very welcome. But I really appreciate the insight and interest from this committee today.
Okay, thank you all very much. Our next petition is petition number 1872, to improve the reliability of Ireland ferry services. I might cheekily say our last new ferry having been launched in 1872, but I won't. this has been launched by Liz McNichol. The petition is calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to urgently ensure that all Islanders have access to reliable ferry services. In its written submission, the Scottish Government outlines action that is being taken in the short and the long term to add resilience to the ferry fleet. This includes exploring opportunities to charter vessels to add resilience in the short term, as well as its long-term commitment to secure replacement vessels, noting several ongoing projects. The SPICE briefing highlights the major inquiry undertaken by the Scottish Parliament's Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee towards the end of Session 5 into the construction and procurement of ferry vessels in Scotland. And this report was published on the 9th of December last year and produced a range of recommendations, including calls for improvements in the strategy for the replacement of ageing vessels in the ferry fleet. Furthermore, in its Session 5 legacy paper, the Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee drew several issues concerning ferries policy to the attention of its successor committee. So those are the submissions and evidence we have. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I think this petition sits with another committee. They've been investigating it quite a lot, and it's high on their agenda. So I'd, under Rule 15.62 of standing orders, to refer it to a Net Zero and Energy and Transport Committee.
On the basis that it can be taken into account as part of its ongoing review of ferry services.
Yes.
So they're already in detail looking at it. Does that meet with the approval? Okay, we will refer this petition to that committee. Thank you. Petition 1873 to provide hypnotherapy for the treatment of mental health, psychosomatic disorders and chronic pain. And this new petition has been lodged by Graham Harvey on behalf of the Scottish Hypnotherapy Foundation. And the petition is calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to instruct the NHS to provide hypnotherapy for the treatment of mental health, psychosomatic disorders and chronic pain. In its submission, the Scottish Government recognises that hypnotherapy may offer relief to some patients, but that it is up to individual NHS boards to decide which complementary and alternative medicines services are made available. So I'm tempted to say again, good luck with that. But however, the submission states that hypnotherapy does not meet the standard of evidence required for recommendation for use as a psychological treatment on the NHS. Similarly, on the issue of addressing chronic pain, the submission points to the Scottish Intercollegiate Network Guidelines, which states that no good quality studies were identified to evaluate the efficacy of hypnotherapy and that further research is required. In response, the petitioner suggests that the main issues are lack of regulation and lack of research. The petitioner explains that hypnotherapy is not regulated because the UK government decided that it is a safe modality and self-regulation should be sufficient. Do we have any comments or suggestions from colleagues? I should say, having been in the Petitions Committee previously, I'm always slightly suspicious when the establishment tries to close any of these things down, because on the basis that there's not evidence, because, of course, without research and trials, there won't be any evidence. So I'm always slightly, slightly nervous about that being the basis in which we agree not to do anything. And I wonder whether there isn't something more we could do to try and evidence any research from wherever it might be available. So, any comments from colleagues? Paul Sweeney.
Well, I note that one of the recommendations is it's up to individual health boards to determine the appropriateness of that service provision. Perhaps it would be worthwhile as inviting each of the health boards to make submissions to see what their view is of provisions within their health board area.
I think that's a very good idea. I'd be very interested to see if there has been any enlightenment in the various health boards in relation to all alternative medicines and other therapies. I seem to recall from a previous petition it was a very, very variable practice, and that, in fact, some health boards subcontracted the work to other health boards or used the facilities. For example, at the time, the Centre for Chronic Pain or whatever it was that the Greater Glasgow Health Board had. So I think it would be useful to get a status on where other health boards see. I just wonder if there's anywhere we could go to try and find if there is any evidence around. Could I ask the clerks to pursue that, maybe just to see if we could, because it does seem that to me that when we're simply told the evidence isn't there, then where can we go to try and find any evidence? Because Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much. None of us here, as to my knowledge, has a medical qualification to be able to decide on for our own benefit, never mind anybody else's, as to whether hypnotherapy could be used in these manners. On that basis, yes, I do believe that it's important that we do take some advice from experts in the field. I think it would be useful to do that, as well as following up on what Paul Sweeney has suggested, which is inviting health boards to give us their viewpoints as to what they want or how they handle such issues. Because I think as health boards and whoever it would be, through the clerks, please, that we could find expert opinion, that will give us a direction to go in, because otherwise we will just have to accept that there's nothing can be done. And I think possibly there could be something that could be done, but we just don't know.
Yeah. No, thank you for that, Bill Kidd. I should say I sit in the cross-party group in chronic pain, and I come across people for whom some of these alternative approaches have clearly had a benefit. But it's sometimes not clear talking to the medical establishment that they accept that it has. I note that the UK government regards it as a safe modality and that self-regulation should be sufficient. Is there anybody in the UK government, we might be a department there, we could as to what they've done to come to that conclusion? We can see. But we're happy to try and establish different routes that we could pursue and keep the petition open. Thank you. Petition number 1874, to introduce legislation to create artillery and firearms exclusion zones around places of spiritual importance and religious worship. And this has been lodged by Dr. Conrad Harvey, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to introduce legislation to create, as stated. In its submission, the Scottish Government outlines the principles which determine what types of development require planning permission, how applications are considered, and the conditions and mitigations that can be applied to when granting planning permission. The Scottish Government states that planning decision takers already have the ability to consider and control noise in a way that reflects the particular circumstances of any proposed development. It also believes that a 5-mile exclusion zone around existing places of worship would be a comparatively blunt approach to controlling noise-generating developments. In his response, the petitioner reiterates his belief that it is inappropriate to have a shooting range within 5 miles of an established cathedral, temple, synagogue, mosque, or monastery. Anybody like to offer a view? David Torrens.
I actually think there's robust legislation within the planning system, and the planning is down to local authorities, so I think it's up to them and they have knowledge about it. I don't know how you're ever going to enforce a 5-mile zone around any cathedral religious place of worship. I'll tell you right now, in Kirkcaldy just now, there's loads of churches and there's a gun range at the back of town. 5 miles would take us to Kinghorn. So I think that's an impossible ask of a petitioner. I'm in mind to close it down under standing rule 15.7 of standing orders, because there is in place enough legislation there for the local planners to decide.
Thank you. I think the Scottish Government submission makes clear it has no current plans to review or amend the legal and policy frameworks around which any of this would operate. So I'm minded to support Mr. Torrance's recommendation. Are we agreed? We are. Thank you. Petition 1875 is a public inquiry into the Scottish Qualifications Authority, the SQA. The next petition is lodged by Jordan Anderson, and it calls upon the government to order a public inquiry into the actions of the SQA during the academic years 2019-20 and 2021. The papers we've received explain that the Scottish Government has committed to establishing a public inquiry into the response to COVID-19, which will be comprehensive. In its submission, the Scottish Government advises that in 2020, it commissioned a review to provide it with a better understanding of how the school curriculum is designed and identify areas of improvement. The remit of the review, which was conducted by the Organisation for Economic Cooperation and Development, was expanded from an initial review of the senior phase curriculum to a full review of the curriculum for excellence. The resulting report was published on the 21st of June this year, and that day the Cabinet Secretary for Education and Skills confirmed that the Scottish Government accepted all of the review's recommendations. She has also stated the Scottish Qualifications Authority will be replaced and Education Scotland substantially reformed. The petitioner states that the replacing of the SQA is not enough in itself and that a public inquiry is needed. Do members have any comments or suggestions to make? Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. I'd just like to say that the past 2 years have been really challenging, extremely challenging for teachers and pupils. And it has been compounded by very poor communication from the SQA and uncertainty over exams, concerns over results. So I would welcome clarity from the Scottish Government on whether the COVID-19 public inquiry will include the award of educational qualifications between 2019 and 2021. And I do remain concerned, particularly as the SQA is to be replaced, that scrutiny of this issue may fall through the cracks. So I'd just like to say that that's very important. It mustn't fall between the cracks.
Okay. Paul Sweeney.
Yeah, I think there are systemic issues that need to be thoroughly investigated, particularly around the effect of these moderation of examinations. I think the pandemic, particularly in 2020, exam diet threw up huge issues with gross inequality, that effectively was a postcode lottery that determined what grades you would be getting, even though the performance academically was the same. So I think we need to seriously investigate the fundamentals of the exam system and how it's operating in Scotland, and I think this is very much a worthwhile exercise. So I would be in favour of writing to the Scottish Government on that basis.
Okay, are we agreed? Can to do that? Sorry, Tess White.
When we write to the Scottish Government, could we just make sure we clarify whether the public inquiry into the response to COVID-19 will include the SQA within its remit?
Yes, I mean, given that public inquiry is taking place, I think it's perfectly reasonable to see whether, and it's now to be a comprehensive review, I think it's perfectly reasonable to see whether this issue could be incorporated into that inquiry, and we'll agree on that basis. Petition number 1877 to provide body cameras for all frontline NHS staff, and this has been lodged by Alex Wallace. The petition is calling on the Scottish Government to urge, the Scottish Government to provide body cameras for all frontline NHS staff and paramedics. The Scottish Government has stated that it does not believe that body cams would be necessary or appropriate for all frontline clinical staff, as the safety risks would vary considerably in different job roles. The submission highlights the Scottish Ambulance Service has advised that there has been no appetite from trade unions to provide body cams, and that attacks on paramedics in Scotland have decreased in recent years. And a feasibility study was conducted by the Scottish Government that believes that the cost of this proposal would be prohibitive for health boards and not provide value for money. Do colleagues, members, have comments or suggestions? David Torrens.
Thank you, Convener. Considering the evidence from Scottish Ambulance Service and the trade unions involved with them and the Royal College of Nursing to say they don't want it, and the Scottish Government don't think it will be value for money and there's no appetite for it, as it says, I think we should close the petition under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Tess White.
Thank you, Convener. Just to state that abuse and attacks on NHS frontline staff are unacceptable. It is worth noting that NHS England have announced in June that thousands of ambulance crews will be provided with body cameras. I think that's really important to say as part of an NHS crackdown to reduce attacks on staff. And they've had successful trials in London and the northeast of England. So I would like to propose that in light of the developments in England, as well as concerns over treatment of frontline NHS staff during the pandemic, it is worth soliciting the views of the Scottish Ambulance Service, the Royal College of Nursing, the BMA and the Allied Health Professions Federation. I think that's really important. So not to close the petition, but actually to look at it further. As I said, because abuse and attacks on frontline staff are very concerning and completely unacceptable, so we shouldn't close the petition.
Except the Scottish Ambulance Service has submitted a submission to us saying that they don't feel there is a demand for it.
The government telling us that.
Fair enough. Well, I'm quite happy to write to various organisations in this instance, if that's your concern. Fair enough. We can do that. Anybody else wish to comment? Right. Well, we'll write to these organisations to see the response we receive. To investigate petition number 1878 to investigate prosecutions under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003, petition lodged by Andrew Muir, calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to investigate why there have been so few prosecutions under sections 315 and 318 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003. The issue was raised in petition number 1786 from the same petitioner in February last year, and at the time the Public Petitions Committee wrote to and subsequently received submissions from the Mental Welfare Commission and the Cabinet Secretary for Justice. The SPICE briefing we've received highlights that an independent review of mental health legislation is currently taking place and will include a review of practice and compulsory detention care and treatment since the 2003 Act came into force. In its submission, the Scottish Government notes that court proceedings under Section 315 were taken in respect of 71 charges, which were reported to the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service from 2007-08 to 2019-20. Out of these, 38 charges led to a conviction. One case was reported to the COPFS on 2018 under Section 318 of the Act, which resulted in no action due to insufficient admissible evidence. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action in relation to this petition? Paul Sweeney.
Thank you, Chair. I believe I've received some submission on this regarding the petitioner, who was very keen to address the committee. So I'd be content for the gentleman to be invited to present to the committee. Understanding is that previously these petitions have been referred to the Mental Welfare Commission, who have recommended then closing the case without action. I believe that his concern relates to the Mental Health Act not having a measure of outcomes that professionals and pharmaceutical companies are held to. So, you know, on that basis, I'd be content with inviting the gentleman to present to the committee, if colleagues are minded to agree.
Bill Kidd.
Yes, thank you very much, Convener. I can certainly see that the argument about inviting the petitioner to come along and make statement. I have to say that as there are no new substantive issues raised in this petition as compared to the previous one from the same petitioner, I think it may be something worthwhile to ask the petitioner if he has anything new that he would wish to raise if he came along to speak to us before we actually have him in to speak to us.
I mean, I think it is worth just reminding ourselves that, you know, it's not appropriate for this committee to investigate an individual case. And that is actually quite clearly stated in the guidance in relation to submitting a petition. Evidence submitted in relation to the petitioner's previous petition and from the Scottish Government on the current petition does not actually appear to highlight any new issues which would merit an investigation into the level of prosecutions under sections 315 and 318 of the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act. So I think we might want to try and elicit some further information as to what we could reasonably take forward before we did that. David Torrens?
I've agreement with Bill Kidd, my colleague. There's somebody who's sitting in the Petitions Committee before and is taking evidence on this petition. I'd like to see if there's actually any new evidence here before we make a decision.
And could we at the moment write to the Scottish Mental Health Law Review seeking an update on its review, specifically in relation to compulsory detention and care and treatment under the Mental Health Care and Treatment Scotland Act 2003. I mean, I'm aware that there was a previous petition and evidence was taken on it. I understand the petitioner is keen to speak with us again, but I think in the first instance, can we agree that we will write to seek just further clarification of whether there is anything new and substantive that hasn't been made aware, of which we haven't yet been made aware, following the previous consideration of a petition before. Yeah. Is that all right? We agree with that? Thank you. Petition 1880 to introduce awareness and practical experience of litter picking and waste separation into the school curriculum. This has been lodged by Callum Edmonds, Susanna Zanata and Tanith Diggory of Clean Up Scotland. And it calls on the Scottish Government to urge the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make an appropriate level of daily cleaning part of the curriculum in schools, including litter picking and waste separation. In her submission, the Cabinet Secretary for Education Skills explains that the Scottish Government is committed to increasing the prevalence of learning for sustainability within the curriculum. And she states that the Scottish Government supports the ultimate aim behind the petition. It believes, however, that individual schools should determine the precise content of their curriculum and how it is applied to the timetable at school level. Although the Scottish Government would prefer to avoid excessive prescription, the Cabinet Secretary states her intention to share details of the petition, as well as her response with Education Scotland and Keep Scotland Beautiful, to ensure the issues highlighted are taken into account. And she will do that in the context of exploring the current programme on litter and waste management to see what within it can thereafter be strengthened. So I think the Cabinet Secretary is quite keen to take forward the sentiments of the petition. Do any colleagues have any comments? Bill Kidd.
Thank you very much, Convener. I, having been on litter picking movements before, actually, in fact, quite recently, I am perfectly aware that a lot of people of all ages, not just children, are throwing litter down, and people will come up and congratulate you and thank you for doing a litter pick, and then you go back to the same area again a week later and it's covered again in litter. So somebody's doing it. I don't know who it is. I do think, though, that the best way to approach this is actually to increase the awareness of the damage to the community, their own community of children, through litter. And I think there's something to be taken out of this. I do understand that it's been suggested that a 12-week public consultation is scheduled to take place by the end of the year, and a refreshed strategy will be published early in 2022. I hope that that is going to include such as those who have actually petitioned us here in order to develop that strategy, and I would like that to be suggested to the Scottish Government.
Thank you. Anybody else wish to comment? So, Paul Sweeney.
I think, Chair, it might be useful, whilst I agree with the Scottish Government's broad intent, I think identifying areas of where schools are actually undertaking very good practical application of teaching could be useful to identify and then share with the broader education bodies in Scotland, because I think, you know, there are pockets of very good teaching in schools. There's a particular school in Easterhouse that does a project called Nae Straw At All, and it's all about a sort of the whole school's engaged in it. It's actually an incredibly inspirational exercise. So I think there's examples in Scotland where really good work's being done, and perhaps those should be identified and shared with or try to transplant the ideas of what they're doing more widely. And I wasn't convinced that the government submission was as enthusiastic about doing that as it might otherwise have been.
Well, given the way in which the government is approaching it and the detailed schedule of actions and the fact that they are going to share the details of the petition and the government's response, I mean, I am minded to close the petition. It does seem to me that, you know, that is a package of actions in place. But I agree there are two actions we could take from that. One, I think we could ask the Scottish Government in developing that consultation whether it would be possible to consult with or potentially utilise the petitioners themselves, since they obviously are an organised interested party. And I think it would be useful to pick up Paul Sweeney's suggestion as well about the best practice and giving that more of a focus, and to do that with the appropriate level of enthusiasm and zest of enthusiasm. But beyond that, I think that given that the government are going to share the petition and are taking forward many of the aims that are within it, I'm minded to close the petition itself. Paul Sweeney?
Just to say for the record, the school I referred to is the Sunnyside School of Conservation. So it's a specialised curriculum that they have developed, and I think it'd be well worth the government taking action to try and benchmark against that.
Which can we draw to their attention? Thank you all very much. We agreed? Yeah. Petition number 1881, longer sentences for paedophiles and sexual predators. This has been lodged by Carol Burns, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to increase the length of time sexual predators serve in jail. In its submission, the Scottish Government explains that the maximum penalty for most serious sex offences, including rape, sexual assault by penetration and sexual assault, is life imprisonment. The petitioner's suggestion is that a minimum sentencing of 4 years in order to provide victims with some peace of mind. The Spice briefing notes that ongoing work is taking place by the Scottish Sentencing Council to prepare sentencing guidelines, including in relation to rape, sexual assault and indecent images of children. I'm minded, colleagues, to write to the Scottish Sentencing Council to seek an update on the progress of its work in this regard, particularly in relation to guidelines on rape, sexual assault and indecent images of children. Given that that work is underway, I think we could usefully receive an update on it. Are we agreed? Tess White.
May I also add, convener, that yes, it's very important to follow up that and seek an update, but also would it be worthwhile contacting Rape Crisis Scotland and Victims Support Scotland to make sure we get their views on it? Because my concern is that their views wouldn't be taken into consideration. So that is a suggestion.
We can do so, but I mean, I think obviously it's important to note that the Scottish Sentencing Council is currently reviewing the issue itself. And in some respects, I would have hoped would have been taking evidence from other parties in relation to their consideration of that. But it's nothing to stop us writing to those organisations as well. Thank you. Petition number 1882, to remand anyone charged with a sexual offence against a child. A new petition lodged by Laura Steele. The petition is calling on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to ensure that any person charged with a sexual offence against a child is remanded in custody. In its written submission, the Scottish Government explains that the Criminal Proceedings, etc. Reform Scotland Act 2007 forms the basis of the current law on bail. As a result of this Act, there is a general presumption in favour of bail. The legislation ensures, however, that any individual could be held in remand where there is a substantial risk that they either might abscond or fail to appear at court, commit a further offence or offences, might interfere with witnesses or otherwise obstruct the course of justice, or where there is any other substantial factor which appears to the court to justify keeping that person in custody. The Scottish Government states, however, that the general presumption in favour of bail is reversed where an individual is accused of indictment in drugs, sexual, violent or domestic abuse offences, and they already have a conviction in solemn proceedings on such a charge. In such cases, the presumption is to remand that individual. The Scottish Government's submission also states that the European Court of Human Rights has developed case law that requires decisions on the remand of individuals accused of offences to be made on a case-by-case basis. As a result, it would not be possible for the Scottish Parliament to legislate so as to require that all individuals accused of certain offences, such as sexual offences, to always be remanded in custody prior to trial. Given that background, do any members have comments or suggestions? In which case, well, David Torrance?
Convener, considering the Scottish Government can't change the law because of case-by-case basis that they have to be judged on, and I don't think there's much we could do with this because a precedent's been set with the European Court of Human Rights, so I think we've got to close it under Rule 15.7 of Standing Orders.
Thank you. Certainly, I think the fact that the Scottish Government can't take forward the aims of the petition because it's out with our legal competence is significant. Our colleagues mind to support David Torrance's suggestion? They are. Thank you. Petition number 1884 is to make whole plant cannabis oil available in the NHS or alternative funding put in place. This petition has been lodged by Steve Gillen, and it calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to make whole plant cannabis oil available on the NHS or provide funds for private access for severely epileptic children and adults where all other NHS epileptic drugs have failed to help. In response to the petition, the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer outlines that the regulation, licensing and supply of medicines remain reserved to the UK Government under the Misuse of Drugs Act 1971, and this includes the scheduling of cannabis-based products for medicinal use. The Chief Pharmaceutical Officer states that specialist doctors across Scotland have a clear and united view that they would be unwilling to prescribe any CBPMs containing tetrahydrocannabinol, longest word today, until there is clear published evidence available following a clinical trial. The submission notes that there is currently a lack of data on dosage, toxicity, interactions and monitoring of long-term side effects. However, the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer has been engaging with the development of clinical trials in refractory epilepsy. Additionally, the Cabinet Secretary for Health and Social Care will be writing to the UK Secretary of State for Health and Social Care to see what additional leverage can be brought to bear on potential solutions, to request an update on the clinical trials' progress, and to ask the manufacturers of CBPMs are encouraged to participate in these trials. Do members have any comments or suggestions? David Torrance.
I would like to keep the petition open, convener, and I think we should write to UK Secretary for Health and Social Care just to seek their views, and especially on the clinical trials, and what progress has been made, because this, I know, does affect certain a range of health complications, which people are saying does help them. So I would like to know if it improves the quality of life, if it's going to be made available.
Thank you for that. Again, this is one of these areas, and I should say, having sat on the cross-party group for chronic pain, I know that there are individuals who will personally testify to evidence they have heard or are aware of somebody who has, under exceptional circumstance benefited. Again, could I ask the clerks to think if there are potentially evidence of other countries where this may be an approved procedure and whether there is therefore any body of evidence there? Because it is, again, one of these issues where we're told the evidence doesn't exist, but it can't exist within our own sphere. I'm obviously, the fact that there are various engagements taking place and potential trials, I think we should be seeking to find out what we can in relation to those. And I am interested in the assertion of the clear and united view, and I just wonder if we could pursue that a little bit more directly ourselves in relation to specialist doctors saying that they would be unwilling to prescribe, and I just would quite like to understand what the reasoning for that would be. Are we happy to pursue that on that basis? Thank you. Oh, sorry, Paul Sweeney.
I agree. I think there's also a consideration that the I think there's also an issue that potentially there is a reconsideration of the regulations around CBD products, although they are currently legal. So I think the point about the Misuse of Drugs Act is a bit of a red herring in this instance. There needs to be further investigation about safe dosage levels. So there could be elements of clinical trials that we can undertake in Scotland, which would be potentially informative. Furthermore, I also think there's been recently established a cross-party group on medicinal cannabis. So it might be useful for the petitioner to consider participation in that cross-party group as a way of also furthering their objectives.
Thank you. Jess White?
Thank you, Jackson Carlo. I'd like to support that and support it keeping it open. So confidentially, a constituent of mine has actually said that, you know, because it's not regulated, I mean, they're taking it for pain relief, but they're having to pay extortionate costs because it's not on prescription. So it's much better for something to be examined, looked at, and clinical trials. And I know there's a suggestion that the individual's, I think, family member takes part in a clinical trial. So I think actually keeping it open, having further clinical trials and exploring it further is a good way forwards.
Thank you. I certainly think we should take forward Paul Sweeney's suggestion in relation to the drawing of the petitioner's attention to the new cross-party group that is being established. I take note of Tess White's suggestion. I think we could write to the Chief Pharmaceutical Officer as well, just in relation to the family member of the petitioner potentially being eligible to participate in a clinical trial that is being talked about. That, I think, would be a useful, productive and proactive suggestion, and we'll keep the petition open meanwhile on that basis and hear back. We agreed, yes, thank you. Petition 1886 to establish a specialist paediatric liver centre in Scotland. This is our final new petition this morning, and it is lodged by Ryan Gowran. And the petition calls on the Scottish Parliament to urge the Scottish Government to establish a specialist paediatric liver centre in Scotland. In its written submission, the Scottish Government explains that at present there is no specific highly specialised service, nor is there the clinical expertise to deliver a paediatric liver transplantation or complex paediatric hepatobiliary surgery within Scotland due to the specialist training required. NHS Scotland therefore commissions these services from NHS England, and these are delivered at King's College Hospital London, St James's University Hospital in Leeds, and the Birmingham Children's Hospital. The submission notes that reimbursement of travel and subsistence for children and their families is the responsibility of the NHS board where the child resides. The Scottish Government states that based on available data, for the last 5 years, NHS Scotland's National Services Division have funded an average of 5 children per year to be assessed and or treated by the specialist paediatric liver services in England. It explains that such a level of need would not be consistent with ensuring the case volumes seen or treated in Scotland would be adequate to sustain a safe, fully staffed, highly specialised service, which is something I think we've seen across other medical disciplines as well. In response, the petitioner states that there are significant costs involved when supporting a family member who has been treated so far from home, and that this puts more strain onto families. And he states that it needs to be easier for families to be reimbursed for these costs, and that long-term hospital families need much better support, arguing that the recently launched Young Patients Family Fund does not provide any true form of assistance for travel to other nations. Do members have any comments or suggestions for action? Paul David. Sweeney, and then Bill Quid.
No, David.
Oh, sorry. And then Paul Sweeney, then David Torrance, then. Thank you.
Thank you, Chair. I think this has hit on, it's been a really timely petition because it's hit on something that's a gap, clearly, in thinking and planning. Whilst I respect the issue about the population base being insufficient to sustain such a service consistently, if it's only 5 cases per year, it wouldn't be, economically viable, nor would it be actually clinically viable, because you couldn't sustain the expertise within that throughput of operations. So to go to a UK level centre of excellence makes sense. However, I think the point about the huge disruption to a family that might cause is actually a very important one, and to actually figure out how we can provide more robust obligations on the health service to provide sustenance, if you like, for families facing that disruption is actually very important. I think that's something that's probably been missed, and there should be greater statutory obligations, perhaps, if necessary, on health boards to ensure that families aren't, detrimented financially because of that.
Yep. David Torrance.
Thank you, Convener. I'd agree with my colleague, Paul Sweeney. I think we should write to Scottish Government to see if we could make it easier for reimbursement of all costs for families travelling, because it is difficult enough to go through that without having to, and many families will not probably be able to afford it. So I think we should try and make it easier for them to be reimbursed for the cost of travelling, accommodation, things like that. And I would like to see Scottish Government do that, so I'd like to write to them.
Okay. I'm very happy to keep the petition open and proceed on that, on the basis as suggested. I do think that very often financial reimbursement is stated as something of an afterthought without proper consideration being given to the mechanisms that will be in place. And when health boards take variable approaches to it, then it can be particularly complicated or not, depending on the health board concerned. Sorry, Paul Sweeney.
Just for the reflection about the issue of reimbursement, obviously we can say that the people who incur costs, but many families won't have the cash flow and even to fund up front. So I think, given there are increasing latitudes for Scottish Government to introduce new benefits, for example, under the 2016 Act, perhaps there might be consideration about whether there's a special grant set up for families. Obviously a very small number of families are affected. Maybe there could be a special grant created to support families up front with payments, enable them to travel and to stay in a location that's quite far from home.
I'm quite happy in our submission to the Scottish Government where we're asking them to explore options to sort of broaden the scope of what those options might be. I do think this can hit any family anywhere, depending on where they are. That incurred cost could be much higher or lower, depending on the accessibility. And if they have to go regularly and either the reimbursement is slow or they don't have access to funding in order to undertake that, even if it is subsequently reimbursed, that can be very prejudicial when they're already in a highly sensitised area of concern over their child's welfare. So quite happy to write to the Scottish Government drawing all that out, because I think the willingness is very often there without a full appreciation of how complicated, nonetheless, the process to actually access funding can be. So I think we're agreed to proceed on that basis. That was our last petition for consideration this morning, so thank you all very much, and I close this meeting of the Citizens Participation and Public Petitions Committee. Thank you.